financial health.
21st Century Radio is sponsored by Hieronymus & Company. This is Talk Radio 680 WCBM. It's time now for award-winning 21st Century Radio with your host, Dr. Zoe Hieronymus.
Everybody needs a helping hand. Take a look at your fellow man and tell me, what can I do today? 'Cause everybody needs a helping out. If that ain't what it's all about, tell me what. What can I do? What can I do today?
Welcome to 21st Century Radio. I'm Dr. Zohara Hieronymus. Laura Kortner is our executive producer, and Anita Rockington runs our board. A wonderful engineer who I've known for so many decades. Such a treat. Joining us this hour is Margaret Ann Lembo, who is a noted author and speaker, sought after for close to 30 years. She is the author of The Essential Guide to Crystals, Minerals, and Stones, and Color Your Life with Crystals. She's a well-known spiritual entrepreneur and practitioner, aromatherapist, and the owner of The Crystal Garden, a bookstore, gift store, and spiritual center in Southeast Florida. She joins us this hour, however, for her most recent book, an invaluable resource for everyone's library, Animal Totems and the Gemstone Kingdom, Spiritual Connections of Crystal Vibrations in Animal Medicine, a Findhorn Press Inner Traditions imprint, 2018. In it, Margaret Ann reveals the energetic connections between 88 different animal allies and 88 gemstones and crystals from the mineral kingdom. This includes animal medicine teachings from a variety of creatures, from hummingbirds and cats to dolphins and birds, to help us find inner peace, knowledge, and wisdom. As Margaret Ann explained so beautifully, quote, all creatures, great and small, in all species on this planet are interconnected. When an animal, insect, bird, or other creature from nature appears repetitively, whether in real life or dreams, it is time to pay attention and find the message that nature is bringing you, unquote. Thank you so much, Margaret Ann, for taking time to join us.
Oh, Dr. Zohara, thank you so much for having me.
Absolutely. Well, your book, you know, when Inner Traditions first sent it to me before it was published and I wrote something for it, they didn't use it, but that was good. What they used was beautiful. But I said to them, this is just such an extraordinary compendium. And I asked them what I will ask you. How do you go about deciding, like, what stones relate to what animals?
I appreciate that question. And, you know, because I have a tendency to think in gemstone terms, like I think of somebody talking about confidence and courage, I think citrine. Right away it comes to mind. So because of the various qualities of each individual animal, insect, bird, fish, whatever it is that we're speaking of in that regard, there's always a matching vibrational energy, and not just one, but multiple matching gemstones for each one of the totems. So I had to pick one for each for the purpose of the book, but I also list the additional vibrational matching stones for
that.
Each one.
And that's what's so, to me, and I did find out my producer, Laura, just told me that the comments I wrote about your beautiful book are on Amazon. I was glad to hear
they
that.
Are.
Well, I was just so taken with the book. You know, you and I are both correspondence seekers or seers in our own work. And it's not everybody in the esoteric community or in the healing community that works with correspondences. And yet it is certainly one of the most ancient methodologies for bringing coherence into our life. So maybe you can share with our audience some basic things, because, you know, over the years, Margaret Ann, I've done a lot of shows about animals, and I'm a big animal lover. And this notion of totems is of particular interest, I think, to most moderners. So let's start with dog. I mean, most people in our audience knows dog. What does dog teach us?
Well, dog is an animal that is often associated, as most people know, with a companionship, with being able to have a loyal companion, regardless of how our behavior might be. And so dog medicine is about companionship and loyalty. Now, we could look to dog for, like, dog tooth calcite, or we could go with even something that has more to do with loyalty and wisdom, which is iolite, which is what I believe I ended up choosing for the book.
Yeah.
There's so many, but that's the main one. But Dalmatian jasper as well, because it helps us to find clarity when we're in the presence of an animal companion. At least I do, by observing their behaviors and how they show us things in our lives.
And it's so interesting to me because you have these other matching gemstones for dogs. I have lots of dogs, always have. And you list some of my most favorite stones: green tourmaline, emerald, jade, lapis lazuli, all rose quartz, sapphire, all things I literally have used over and over again in my life. So I found it very interesting. What about crow? I mean, people see crows in their daily lives and sometimes more than others.
Well, you know, when crow shows up for me personally, I take a look at what message is being sent to me. Am I supposed to be paying attention to something that I wasn't? And so if they come into my sphere and show me over and over and over again by their caw, you know, they speak to me by cawing, mm-hmm. I'm like, okay, I actually stop and I ask them, what are you trying to tell me? And then I listen. And when I say I listen, I am very clairaudient, and I bet you are too.
Yeah.
And so I listen to, what are they saying? What are they saying? So I have to listen to myself mm-hmm. and hear through what is going on. And it may be like just something that was very ordinary, and it could be much more esoteric where you're getting messages from your spirit guides and they're trying to get your attention and you're not paying attention.
Mm-hmm. And so then with each animal, and people ask me these things all the time, and I don't always know that I have the right answer. I can give, you know, an idea, but I'd be curious how you see it. So somebody will say to me, well, Zoe, you talk about, you know, when we see an animal in our life, no matter what it is, to pay attention. And they'll say, well, in the course of the day, I might see a spider in my house. I might see, you know, a field mouse running. I might see a deer across the street. I might see a blue jay alight on the tree. And they say, am I supposed to pay attention to them all? And of course, you know, the simple answer for me is yes. Yes, you are. Mm-hmm. But mm-hmm. how do people sort about what is the more important one and why is it important and what can they learn? And then basically how to take this relationship, because to me, it's always about a relationship with the animal, the gemstone, not just this simple thing of what can I do to use it for myself?
Mm-hmm. Yes, well, thank you, because this is a really, I love to talk about it in this regard. So first, the first part of your discussion there, I would say if something is repetitive, like every day or within the past 3 days, you have repetitively the same animal. Like the other day, I saw it was a clownfish, but they look like goldfish in the mm-hmm. in a tropical way. And then shortly thereafter, and this is going to sound silly, but I color on my face on my little iPad at night sometimes while I'm relaxing into the evening, and the first one that popped up is the same exact scene as what I saw within that tropical fish tank.
Oh, fascinating!
I thought, wow, this to me is a message from goldfish. So when I went and looked at goldfish, wouldn't you know that goldfish? Even though I wrote the book, so I'm supposed to remember all this, not. But I read it from a standpoint of someone looking at it for the first time. And I saw, if you're attracted, you know, if goldfish is your totem, then you may be attracted to working with colors and chakras and gemstones. And I thought, oh, my goodness.
That's so funny.
Isn't it funny? But it's also to remind me to focus on good luck, good fortune, and good health. Because a series of incidents over the past months, even over the past year, we're challenging, you know. We go through life challenge. We all have cycles. And goldfish came into my life at this time to remind me to realign with goodness and happiness and good companions and good luck and good fortune. So it's a matter of interpretation without going into analysis paralysis is how I look
right,
at it.
Right, right. Well, you know, but it is interesting because as many people as there are who write about animals and their meaning, all of us add a little something different through the lens of our life experience. What I find so incredible about your work, Margaret Ann, though, is your intimacy with the gems and minerals. And I know you're an aromatherapist, so also obviously with the flower kingdom. Talk to us a bit about your own origins in beginning this work, because I think, you know, oftentimes our guests are the elders, are the leaders in their fields, and we don't always have an opportunity to talk about how other people can get started how one goes about improving their own intuition and how they themselves then can use their own intuition to either talk to the plants or the trees or the birds or the minerals or the rocks, etc.
Mm-hmm. Well, the origins really stems literally from my origins, from the early days of my life. I was blessed to have a mom that was, even though I grew up in a very healthy, strong, a Roman Catholic home, Italian Roman Catholic home. My mom taught me telepathy. She taught me to communicate, to listen to the plants and understanding and connecting, you know, in our garden, in our backyard in Brooklyn, as well as a beach house sand garden where she was able to grow amazing fruit, vegetables, not so much fruits, but vegetables in beach sand. So from the, you know, just really basic earth-grounded teachings combined with a very strong spiritual foundation from, you know, I didn't have a negative Roman Catholic experience. I had a very positive one, the mystical.
How lovely.
And observing the mystical and connecting with the saints and the angels. It's a very strong foundation. And then to, like, fast forward, when I moved from mortgage banking in the corporate world into creating my store and center, this conscious living center, the aromatherapy like just made total sense in connection when I got certified back in the day. This is quite a while ago, because of the blending of all of these teachings, because the essence and energetics of each one of those essential oils also brings a message and has a matching gemstone. And yes, even has a matching animal, vibrational match.
Exactly. Well, and I think, and color, you know, and then the chakras. And there's so many layers that anyone
can. And the numerology.
Keeps
going on and on.
And the astrology, exactly. And homeopathy and electromagnetics and music. You know, there really is a language of the spheres, and all of these things are connected. So to a person listening in the audience, let's sort of walk through what happens in a day, and how these kinds of awarenesses can deepen our life experience. So let's say somebody wakes up and they have roses on their table and they walk over and they smell the roses. I mean, that sounds so quaint, but what happens?
From there, you can also say, okay, well, rose energy is associated with, in my world, it's associated with Mother Mary or the Divine Mother, the vibration of the divine feminine, and then moving into deeper into the heart chakra center and knowing that blossoming of the rose and opening the heart center to love, to give love, to be love, to express love as much as possible, and then establishing a strong foundation of a very strong affirmation, a positive, a gentle and strong affirmation. You know, I am love. All that is attracted to me and all that is surrounded around me is love, and therefore I can be supported by my community and I can be supportive in my community. And the more we keep our attention and awareness on positive thought forms with that idea of focusing on love, all from smelling that rose first thing in the morning, then you might pick up a rose quartz to put in your pocket or wear your rose quartz bracelet that day and maybe your moonstone to go with it to really amplify that divine feminine energy and just keep focusing on positive thought forms, affirmations. And by focusing on the affirmations, which you well know, I'm sure, Dr. Zoe, that this is something that creates our reality. We design our reality in this regard.
Mm-hmm. It is an interesting phenomena, you know, and I'd say to people, it's not magic, it's science, you know, that where we put our mind, matter follows. And a lot of people think they're victims of things, and it sounds so cold sometimes to suggest to anybody, myself included, well, you had a whole lot to do with bringing this into your life, whatever it is, the traffic jam you're stuck in, or a bad breakup, or you stub your toe.
Yes, because we do create our reality, so we have to ask ourselves, what am I thinking? What am I thinking? And then, of course, that brings about that, you know, this new word that's, well, it's not new, but it seems to be really, you know, popular these days is mindfulness. And mindfulness is simply being consciously aware of what you're thinking and what you're focusing on And that in itself brings awareness. Awakening consciousness is what it's all about.
Exactly. Exactly. And true, whatever we practice, we improve at. So if we practice at our intuition gets stronger. And I loved because you talked about rose and rose quartz. Of course, I had to look up, well, what animals is that? Beaver, bluebird, buffalo, dog, dove, duck, finch, flamingo, hawk, penguin, swan, and vulture. That's what's so incredible is that in your work, there might be a primary association, but then you see all of these other relatives, let's just call them relatives in the family, mm-hmm. that are related to the gemstone. So maybe when we come back, we can talk a little bit about color, because you work so much with color. And when you talk about stones, the way you speak to minerals and stones is that, you know, these are earth witnesses. So when we pick up a stone as we walk in the woods, that stone has memory. I know some people in their audience going, oh, there she goes again on her stuff. But this is ancient and it is true. It's not just opinion. We'll be right back. Our guest is the extraordinary Margaret Ann Lembo and her most recent beautiful book. I encourage all of you to get this because it will only open up your mind, your heart, and your life to new things. Animal Totems and the Gemstone Kingdom. Spiritual connections of crystal vibrations and animal medicine. A Findhorn Inner Traditions 2018 release.
Hello, this is Tim Link, author of Talking with Dogs and Cats. You can find out more about my book, Talking with Dogs and Cats, and the work that I do with animals by visiting my website, which is wagging-tales.com. That's wagging-tales.com. You can find out more about what your animals are thinking and how to have the best life possible with them. You're listening to 21st Century Radio with Dr. Sahara Hieronymus.
Welcome back to 21st Century Radio. Margaret Ann Lembo is our guest. You can learn more about her extraordinary work and how varied it is in so many areas. www.margaretannlembo.com. And her most recent book that we're examining together tonight is Animal Totems and the Gemstone Kingdom, Spiritual Connections of Crystal Vibration and Animal Medicine. It's a Findhorn Inner Traditions imprint. And there are also animal ally cards, gemstone guardian cards, that make a wonderful gift for somebody young or old. You know, and that's also something, Margaret Ann, about your work is that it doesn't matter what age a person is, anybody can benefit by what you teach.
Well, thank you. That's my intention and my hope as well. Yeah, I'm hoping that the younger generation can have some opportunity to learn from the information and ingrain it early in their lives like I was blessed to be able to do.
Yeah,
you
are blessed in that way. So right before the break, I mentioned something you write about and teach is that crystals, minerals, and stones hold the history of the earth and all this planet has to offer us. And some people, you know, they might collect stones because they like the way they look. They collect all white stones or all dark stones or a particular mountain stone, or they collect stones from where they go. How does a person come into rapport with a stone that they have found?
Well, the way I approached it and continue to approach it is I like to look at where did the rock grow? How did that mineral grow in the earth? Was it because of a volcanic eruption? What kind of minerals are combined together to create the stone? You know, how does it come together? And then the colors, of course. What colors do they come in, and how does that relate to each one of the energy centers, the chakra system of the body, mind, and spirit? And that way you can take a look and see that, like rose quartz, like we mentioned already, rose energy is going to be primarily about love. And whereas another quartz, like smoky quartz, that's going to be more about grounding. So it has more to do also with the color and what energy that associates in regard to the chakra system.
Mm-hmm. And so let's say somebody in listening audience goes out for a walk and they bend down and they go, oh, what a pretty stone. And the person they're walking with says, don't take that stone. That stone belongs right where it is in the woods. And the person says, no, I feel really attracted to this stone. Like, maybe it should go home with me.
Hmm. Well, I pick up stones and bring them home. So hopefully I'm not doing the wrong thing there. My intention is always to, you know, do what's right. So I don't know the answer to that. What do you think?
Well, that's why I was asking you, because I do it too. And
oh, okay.
But I'm very particular, and I always ask the stone, does it want to go on a journey with me? And then what I do, like I just sold a house and I had taken some river rocks there that sat with a Buddha at the front door. And I've moved and packed everything up. So I took those rocks and the Buddha with me. And the mm-hmm. rocks now are going to a new location. I mean, I think like everything, probably as you do as well, and maybe many in our audience, that everything is living. And so everything changes. But there is a consciousness in the rock. And I think that that's the part that sometimes disturbs me, is that people take things, whether it's a rock or something else from nature, or they break something in nature because it's pretty and they want to take it home. But it doesn't necessarily get valued as a member of the family. And I don't mean that mm-hmm. in the same way a human member, but it still has consciousness.
Right, a sacred object. Yeah. Well, you know, I sell rocks for a part of my living. So
mm-hmm, right.
I hope it's okay that people are coming and getting rocks, whether they're finding it in nature or finding it in the, you know, on the shelves of the crystal garden. That's what I do for my life. And my intention is that every single rock that you work with, every single crystal or mineral or gemstone has a value from the standpoint of helping us with focusing our attention, our awareness. So a sodalite on one day, which is a dark blue stone that's much like lapis lazuli, may be one that you're using to, you know, really stay calm and peaceful and keep a good way of communication with other people. Well, that's value. That's a vibration. So I don't know how to resolve taking stones from nature, to be honest with you.
There's anything necessarily wrong per se. I think it's just mm-hmm. a question of awareness that we, you know, anything that the earth gives us is not just a utility to be exploited, but a relationship to enter into. And I think that's what mm-hmm. I'm trying to say, is that
gotcha.
Oftentimes we objectify things. So we treat them as inanimate objects with no purpose other than our pleasure. Versus a symbiotic relationship that the stones also will take your story to whoever else comes into contact with that rock next.
Interesting. Very cool.
So when
I like to work with gemstones in every regard. It just for keeping me on task, to keeping me positive, keeping me staying focused on love and goodness. Some days it works better than others, but that's part of being human on the planet, right?
Right, exactly. Well, it's all part of consciousness. So I also look at anything we use from nature that if we give our attention and our good intention to it, benefits the universe, not just ourselves and not just that stone. Because mm-hmm. as you point out, what we're ultimately talking about is vibrations or frequency, and then behind that is the light. When you look, Margaret Ann, as you do, at all of these, I guess it's various ways animals can teach us things, different parts of the world will look at them in a different way, but you have found a way to assign them to the directions. How did you do that?
So for many, many years, I've been working with, studying, experiencing, creating medicine wheels, wheels of life, you know, that are based on earth-centered astrology, which is, you know, connecting with each one of the directions, but also each one of the moons in between each one of those directions, and the cross quarters, as well as even the pathways that bring us to the center of our own consciousness. So I first started learning this early 80s, it was probably the late 80s, to work with based on Sunbear's book and also some teachings from spiritual teachers, medicine men and women that I worked with or learned from over the years. And so I look at the directions also as a tool for a portal for understanding and for connection with the archangels and the angels. So like Michael's in the east, and there's certain stones that would work with that, and certain animals that are aligned with that. And that would be a very long conversation, but just, you know, based on the medicine wheel teachings of both Native Americans here in the United States, as well as the Incas in Peru, and the, because I used to take people on sacred sites journeys and tours, and that taught me a lot in regard to the energy of the directions, also the indigenous people, the Mayans, as well as the Aztecs, and so many more, our own Four Corners region. There's so many teachings of the Hopis that all come together and have very much a similarity in regard to each one of these directions. Mm-hmm. I hope that just made sense.
No, it makes total sense. It just always interests me when you look at correspondences, how sometimes they'll overlap from one tradition to another culture, and sometimes they don't. And then it's up to each person, as you point out, you know, to operate your medicine wheel with awareness. When you then do that, like, for instance, the East Path, you have, like, the bluebird and the deer and the giraffe. And then the South Path, I mean, there are many more on it. You have the beetle, the coyote, and the dog. So when a person uses your book and they go, all right, well, you know, I've been thinking about the gorillas. And they look it up and they find that the gorilla's a West Path. What does that mean for them?
Well, if you delve in, when one delves into the understanding of the directions, going into the West is the place of introspection, of going within, of being. And gorillas do rest. They nest and they and luxuriate in it. They enjoy it. So this may be a signal to go within. Like right now, we're energetically the fall equinox, and all the way to, you know, this time of year up until the winter solstice is inward work, going inside ourselves to contemplate, to go within to know the truth, to go to the look within place to know. With other areas, you know, when we get to the spring or summer, we're more out, and just like we're out in nature, we're out in the fresh air and the sunshine, where autumn traditionally, especially in this hemisphere, we're going inside.
And so, again, back to your book and the way a person can use this, not only could the direction you're attracted to, like somebody could say, like, I love Western light. And so I would then perhaps look up the animals and the gemstones associated with the Western path. Is that one of the ways one could use this?
I hadn't thought of that, but, you know, I guess so. You know, I look at it as more of looking not so much West as in a place to live, as in West as in a direction in the in our wheel, like, mm-hmm. you know, when we get up in the morning and look to the east, the sun is rising, and that's a place of seeing life from anew again, you know, when, you know, how you wake up and you understand things and you know, you learn. So that's a new day, a new dawn, whereas at the high noon, things are very bright. We can see things much clearly, and that's the time of our summer solstice. And so we can go all the way around the wheel and go into each one of the meanings of each of these directions more from a standpoint of contemplative thought and self-understanding and advancing self-awareness.
Mm-hmm.
Does that make sense to you?
For sure. And you also point out, I mean, you have such facility with so many different systems. When I started looking at your book, and then we're into the angels, and then after the angels, we have the animals, and after the animals, the gemstones. And then we can add, you know, if you lay on your other books, the aromatherapy and the flowers.
Yeah.
I just think it's so interesting. As an example, turtle. I bring up turtle because you mentioned a stone I've never even heard of. That's the other thing. It's such an education, Margaret Ann, using your works, because you know such a vast amount. I mean, obviously, there are hundreds of thousands of animals and insects, and you chose 88. By the way, how did you select the ones you use?
Okay, so this is the story. So I've chose the number 88 because I like, you know, the double-digit numbers, you know, the mastered numbers. But the first deck, and I'm hoping there'll be a second, but the first deck, there's 44 cards in the deck, and I don't want to repeat any gemstones from my first three decks. So, you know, I'm trying to provide my readers, my followers, the opportunity to have a different gemstone in every single deck. They're never going to get a repeat.
Wow.
And that was the intention. And then as far as which animals, I had to go with, like, ones that I was somewhat familiar with, because mm-hmm. I don't know about every animal. I'm not, you know, mm-hmm. an expert in that regard from the standpoint of all their habits. That would be a lot for me to say.
For sure.
But the research, based on the ones that I'm most attracted to, and because of building the medicine wheel, when I do medicine wheel teachings and walk the wheel and we do the ceremonials, when we build it, I'm telling a story to go with each one of the 36 rocks, each one of the positions, I should say, of the medicine wheel. And each one is associated with an animal. So there are certain animals that I've used in storytelling teaching that I figured would work really great in the book, and so I just had to find what vibrational match would work with the gemstones that I had available. It sounds like ridiculous, but that's part of the reasoning behind it, and that's why I had to have the additional gems.
Yeah.
Because I didn't want to repeat any gems, you know, for the sake of shuffling a deck, so to speak, an oracle.
Well, it's beautiful.
Yeah, good, thank you.
It really is. I mean, I turned to praying mantis because I found one that had ossified when I was moving, and I love praying mantis, and it's a stone I've never heard of, Mookite Jasper.
It's a jasper that comes out of Australia, and it comes in shades of maroons and reds and golden yellows, and it's just a beautiful gemstone. So there are so many jaspers, but that particular one comes out of Australia.
Hmm. And the affirmation is, I embrace the hard-earned lessons of the past to catapult me into a bright and positive future. That's the other thing, is you include in your beautiful book, Animal Totems and the Gemstone Kingdom, the book we're talking about this evening, not only the location of the animal on the Wheel of Life, but what we can contemplate, and then the message from the individual animal, and then the affirmation, and then a message from the stone, and then additional vibrational matching stem stone. So I'll ask you what I sometimes think about my husband, who is a symbologist. Like, he walks around and everything's a symbol. So there's always this story that is so big going on. You know, I'm walking to the car and he's seeing the universe. You know,
I love that. That's wonderful.
But I would think that a person like yourself, you know, you see a bluebird and then all of a sudden you're thinking of the gemstone, and then you're thinking about the flower. How does it work for somebody with a mature relationship to all of these correspondences, or the angel?
So what do you mean with a mature?
For yourself, you are the mature person who has just such facility with all these correspondences. Does your mind immediately go, oh, yes, that's the angel of abundance. Oh, yes, that's the buffalo.
No.
Oh,
I would love to say that it does, but that would be just so full of myself if I said that. No, I actually, like I told you, I look it up.
I
wrote this book so fast.
Mm-hmm.
This was oh my gosh, it came out of me so fast.
Mm-hmm.
And so I remember when I was done, it's like, how am I going to talk about this? This came out of me really fast.
Mm-hmm.
I don't even, you know. And so
I do know exactly what you speak to.
Thank you. So I was like, well, I probably have to study my own work. You know,
well, that's what I always joke. Margaret Ann, I always tell people I'm a student of my own books.
I love it. Oh, gosh, I love that. Thank you for the empathetic vibe.
Yeah. Well, it's really true. You know, until you've written books, and particularly when you're pulling down information using your intuition and
mm-hmm.
your higher mind, which is not rational, it's intuitive.
Mm-hmm.
You really are, in some respects, I don't want to use the word channeling because it has become so diluted, but
mm-hmm.
it's the way great teachings are often brought to the world. You know, the intuition opens up, whether it's a scientist or an author or a poet, or in your case, is extraordinary correspondence expert. It does flow through us, because I believe there's always teachers on the other side looking for vessels that are living to pour into. And you don't have to be a genius. What you have to have is love in your heart and the desire to be of service. And
yeah.
Then I think all these other elders on the other side go, oh, look, there's Margaret Ann. Let's use Margaret Ann for this book.
I do feel that way. I do feel that way. I did a lot of research regarding the animals to know their qualities, but also my original author mentor is Ted Andrews, who is on the other side.
Yeah.
And he's the one that introduced me to to Llewellyn Worldwide, who first published me with my first book, Chakra Awakening.
Oh, how interesting.
Which is still, you know, still in print and still rolling well and in like 8 languages or whatever it is, you know, it's going good. And so when I first got the divine inspiration, and it truly was divine inspiration, I woke up and knew exactly this title that I came to my desk that I'm sitting at right now talking to you, and I wrote it down exactly like this, and I zipped off an email asking 2 different publishers, you know, are they interested? And boom, it was like spit spot fast, you know, boom, yes,
isn't that lovely?
Please give it to me.
It's lovely. Well, there are those connections, and I think people in our listening audience certainly know that Bob and I believe it. Many of our guests will speak to it, that, you know, Ted wrote beautiful books on animals and animal talk and totems, and we had him on a number of times. And it does work that way, that when we are in an affiliate field, we're probably in a similar soul group, and we come together to do this work as a community, whether we're in our body or out of our body. And that's why I say, you know, the books I've written on Kabbalah, I would have to study my own books now to be able to teach them. When I first wrote them, they were really close and intimate to my conscious mind. But after 7 or 8 years later, I look at them and I go, how did I know all of this?
Yeah.
So I do know what you speak to. And now people are going, see, Zoe doesn't know what she's talking about.
Yes, you do. And that's interesting because Ted Andrews was very connected with the Kabbalah as well.
Oh, interesting. I didn't know that.
He wrote a few books on it. Yeah.
Huh,
I can't think of the exact name of it in this moment. I think he wrote 2 different books on it.
I'll have to look it up. I'll look it up. Well, there you go. Soul groups are soul groups. We'll be right back with my soul sister, Margaret Ann Lembo, her book, Animal Totems and the Gemstone Kingdom, Spiritual Connections of Crystal Vibrations and Animal Medicine, a Findhorn Inner Traditions imprint, 2018 release. Learn more at www.margaretannlembo.com.
Hello, this is Dr. Deborah Erickson. I'm a parapsychological researcher exploring the human-animal bond through telepathic interspecies communication. You can learn more about me and my work at www.deboraherickson.com. You are listening to 21st Century Radio with Dr. Zahara Hieronymus.
Welcome back to 21st Century Radio. Don't forget, all of our guests programs are archived online for free. You can find them at www.21st21stcenturyradio.com. And first caller right now at 410-922-6680. That's 410-WCBM-680 or 1-800-922-6680. If you know the author of the book we're discussing this evening, you will win a copy of her book, courtesy of Findhorn Inner Traditions Press. The book is Animal Totems in the Gemstone Kingdom. And again, if you know the author we're talking to this evening, you'll be a winner of her book. So I want to come back to some of the things that you do and all of the ways in which you integrate, whether it's animals or gems or aromatherapy, etc. People often ask me because, you know, I'm big into change and I like change, but not everybody does. And some people say, you know, I think I only have one totem animal, but I'm not quite sure of it. How do you go about identifying? I mean, you did say already to us, and we talk about this. I bring it up again because it's the question I'm always asked the most, no matter how many shows I do about it. They say, well, you know, I see deer because of where I live, or I see, you know, chipmunks, or I see squirrels, but they aren't necessarily my totem. How does one identify whether it's the gem or the totem that is most important for them?
Well, let's talk about, if you don't mind, first the energy of an animal.
Okay.
And I believe that we have a totem pole, if you will. We have multiple animals that are our guides, and some are more predominant than others. So for any one of us, we might have dreams about an animal. We come across the animal in nature, or we just like that particular animal and we don't understand why. So, like, you know, maybe you collect elephants or you collect owl statues or things that are inanimate but still are symbolic of that particular animal. will just be honor your husband and talk about symbology.
Right.
and that in itself sometimes is a clue that, well, you're drawn to this. It's constantly on your mind. You always want to have an owl or an elephant or a frog in your myth. Well, then that is more than likely going to be mm-hmm. your particular power animal, and one is going to be maybe more predominant than another. So like, for example, spider shows up for me when I need to write and I haven't been writing. Whereas, if I see, let's say a snake, which is rare for me to see a snake, but I have snakes show up, or all of a sudden the snake's on TV, or there's mm-hmm. a lot of things about snakes. I might pay attention to what am I trying to unpeel? Where am I going to transform, to change, to go to the next level, to peel off that layer and transform and move higher? So I hope I've answered that question. I kind of went on a little tangent
there. No, I think you did. I loved what you said about we have a totem, a pole,
yeah.
which means more than one animal. I mean, even when I was a kid, I had two nicknames that my mom gave me, and people said, that makes no sense whatsoever. She called me Mouse, and she also called me Tiger. And these were different qualities that I had.
Mm, sweet.
Yeah, so go
are
ahead.
You detail-oriented?
Sure.
Are you? Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Why? Is that what the mouse does?
Yes, mouse is very, I think this is very much about scrutiny. You know, that's one aspect of what mouse is about.
Mm-hmm.
Many things for each one of our animals, don't you think?
I do. And I think in your book you talked about the small voice within with, you know, using scent, and it's really important to me. Scent always has been. It's so fascinating. And then tiger, well, I was a very aggressive athlete, and I've been a whistleblower, so that was totally appropriate. Even as a child, she understood where I was headed.
That's nice.
Yes,
isn't
it
that
is.
Isn't that lovely?
It is. And I, you know, there was one that I came across that I just thought was so beautiful. Seagull and aquamarine. That is such a beautiful combination.
And seagull, if I'm remembering right, see, here I am having to test myself, has also to do with our digestion. You know, the ability to digest what's going on around us.
Mm-hmm.
So aquamarine has to do also with communication and energetically connecting with the ocean and water and our emotions, but also our way of, oh yeah, I just pulled it up on my screen so I could look. For sure, it is about to look within and balance out. One person's trash is another person's treasure.
Yeah.
So see what you need to pass on to other people.
Yeah. You know, you've been involved now for 3 decades or more in all these fields. How have they changed? Let's start with aromatherapy.
Well, aromatherapy wasn't that like it is now. It's kind of changed because of multi-level marketing companies.
Yeah.
And I don't want to get started on that on the air. But I will say that, you know, when I was in the corporate world, I started working with essential oils and getting to know them, and took some classes back then. You know, I've been involved on a metaphysical level my whole entire life. I just didn't know it was called metaphysics at that time, you know, working beyond the ordinary. So, you know, I was introduced to Edgar Cayce as early as like 6 years old.
Yeah,
you know,
lovely.
This was. Yeah.
What a
thanks
blessing.
Thanks to a dear friend of the family, Vic. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, it is interesting because aromatherapy now has gotten into the women's magazines, and now it's in the bath product and in cleaning supplies, and, you know, where it used to be. And it's always been a very holy art, because through our sense of smell, in the Jewish tradition anyway, it's the neshama. That's the soul that's breathed into you at birth. And it's through scent that we can elevate our consciousness, quite simply. Which is incense, and when you think about all the different traditions worldwide that have used scent for mm-hmm. changing consciousness. Well, we're going to be out of time. I have so many other questions I'd love to ask you. What haven't we talked about that you'd love to give a shout out to?
Oh, I guess I would just like to really give a shout out one more time, because we did touch on it, is staying focused on being loved. The more that we all focus on it, myself included, and gratitude for all that we do have in our lives. And that brings more love and more gratitude, more things to be grateful for. So I think that's where I can leave it for today.
Oh, that's a lovely thing. And, you know, we all wish you the best. I know you're in, where are you, in Boynton Beach? No, you're somewhere in Florida.
Palm Beach County, yeah. My store is in Boynton Beach, and I live in Lantana, yeah. Very, very lovely area, right in the near West Palm Beach, if you will.
Yeah, so you get a lot of sun all of the time, and a lot of women down there who are interested in all of these different things. Do you find that there are more men slowly over time becoming interested in these more intuitive arts?
Very much so. Very much so. More men than we've ever had before. You know, my store is in business 30 years now, and it used to be only women coming in. And then it started to be a little bit of, you know, 80-20. I would say we're getting to maybe 70-30, you know, 30% men, maybe even 40% men.
Oh, wonderful.
So it has increased, and I will say improved, that they're open to that, and I appreciate it very much.
Yeah, it's lovely. Well, I want to encourage our audience to buy your book and your cards, Animal Totems and the Gemstone Kingdom, Spiritual Connections of Crystal Vibrations and Animal Medicine. The author is Margaret Ann Lembo. You can learn more about her work at www.margaretann, without an A. That's Margaret, MargaretAnnLembo.com. And, you know, again, I thank you because I think you've contributed something that many authors would try, but they don't necessarily always get there.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me on your show. I appreciate it.
You're welcome. And as Melissa Alvarez says of this book, Lembo has created a spectacular guide you will turn to time and time again. This book should be in everyone's personal library, and I do agree. Thank you so much for being with us, Margaret Ann.
With stimulating talk and breaking news on Talk Radio 680 WCBM, Baltimore, and WCBM.com. The Caravan Coming Closer.